On the cutting edge of the new mainstream, Christine Upchurch is passionate about bringing together science, psychology, and spirituality in a way that can be applied to our everyday lives for true transformation. The Christine Upchurch Show, stellar conversations to illuminate your journey, engages some of the most inspired visionaries on the planet in lighthearted, lively dialogue. Join us as we explore the expansive nature of reality in a down-to-earth way, offering you insights and tools, empowering you to become that bright light you're meant to be. Now, here's your host, Christine Upchurch.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Christine Upchurch Show, where we have stellar conversations to illuminate your journey. I'm speaking to you today from Seattle here at Hubbard Radio on KKNW AM 1150. You might be listening somewhere in Connecticut, Rhode Island, or New York on WBLQ AM 1230, somewhere across the United States on cable radio network through your television, or on one of the many stations in Australia, or anywhere around the world on Transformation Talk Radio. But I have to tell you, wherever you're joining us from today, either live or in the archives on christineupchurch.com, you are going to be very excited you've joined us because I have one of my favorite guests here today. And I'm not going to even say who that is before I say hello to my better half here in the studio, Mr. Benny Mathers.
Hi, Christine.
Hey, Benny. How are you?
Good. You look bright-eyed and bushy-tailed. Inside joke. We'll talk about it.
Yeah.
So I know you asked me about the news. There's not that much more to report, just to kind of kick things off. However, I did come across a story someone found could be possibly the oldest message in a bottle.
Really? How
found
old is it?
On a, it's expected at 108 years old and 31 days. 108, 31. Floating around in the North Sea. Could you imagine, like, just randomly, you know, every kid has kind of like that little theory, like, or the dream, like, oh, I'll put a little message in a bottle, throw it out in the ocean, and see what happens.
It's just really floating around out there. So is it a profound message?
I'm currently in the middle of the story right now. It seems pretty it looks like a postcard requested item. A marine biologist found it at a world. It's in the Guinness Book of World Records, probably. I'll have more at the next break.
Okay, that sounds good.
I just wanted to come up. I think that's just kind of cool. It just kind of led me onto a little bit of like, I did it when I was a kid. I think a lot of kids did that.
And, you know, it actually is symbolic of how we all have some sort of effect on our world that lasts well beyond. I imagine whoever sent that bottle 108 years ago has passed on.
So basically, now while you were speaking, it says, inside was a postcard requested its return to a British marine biologist, George Parker Binder, or Biter, with the promise of a single shilling upon arrival. Wow.
Yeah, he's not going to pay it.
No, he's not going to get that.
Oh, that's good times. Well, you know, our guest today is Robert Moss. And I have sort of a hard time describing Robert because he is so unique. If you took the childhood curiosity, enthusiasm, and courage for exploration, and you combined that with intellectual and articulate man, and you applied it to spirituality and our dream life, you get Robert Moss. It's this fascinating combination, and he's got unique perspective on things. He is a dream teacher. He's the creator of active dreaming. He was born in Australia, and he had three near-death experiences as a child. And he's gone on to explore reality in a variety of ways. It's just fascinating. He leads popular seminars all over the world. He's a best-selling novelist, and he's got a recent book out that's just fascinating and fun. It's called Sidewalk Oracles, Playing with Signs, Symbols, and Synchronicity in Everyday Life. I love the fact that he's gone from the dream world to the waking world. I'd like to welcome Robert Moss. Welcome to the Christine Upchurch Show.
Always good to be with you, Christine. I'm listening to Benny's story about the bottle, the message in the bottle discovered after 100-plus years. And I think of one of my favorite recent novels. It's called A Tale for the Time Being by Japanese-American author Ruth Ozeki. But something like a message in a bottle that washes up on the West Coast after the Asian tsunami, after the Japanese tsunami of 2011. And it's about how dreaming and writing can change time tracks, how one parallel reality can move upon another in a positive way. Ooh. So although we have a more maybe pedestrian story, it puts me in mind of, you know, larger possibilities.
Right. And I love this concept of parallel realities. And I want to talk about that. But first things first, Robert, I'm curious about how you made your way from this fascinating dream work you do to focusing on sidewalk oracles in our everyday life.
Oh, it's a seamless web, really. There's no dreaming culture that considers dreams for the night separate from signs and symbols during the day in what Australian Aborigines call the speaking land. I've always looked at both. I mean, looking at coincidence, pop-up signs and symbols in the world around you is a dreamer's way of operating in everyday life, frankly.
Right, right.
I think the relationship between dreaming and studying and playing with synchronicity is this. When we go dreaming, we get out there. We go beyond the body and the brain, whatever the neuroscientists think. We get beyond the body and the brain. We get out there. We have experiences maybe in another reality, maybe a reality where the dead are alive. We have access to places of healing and adventure and creation and initiation. Through synchronicity, the powers that are living in the deeper reality in those hidden dimensions of the real come pushing or probing through the curtains of our ordinary understanding to bring us awake. Sometimes they tickle us awake gently. Uh-huh. Sometimes they give us a wink. Sometimes they give us a handshake. Sometimes they pull the rug from under us. So it's always been the same to me. I've always lived in both these worlds by both these methods, paying
right.
attention to dreams and paying attention to what the world around me gives me in what some, often feels like a set of dream symbols from everyday life.
Right. And it's funny because the way you're talking about it, it sounds to me like you have this perspective that on some level we are more awake when we're sleeping. And when we're awake, we need to use these signs and symbols to help us become more awake.
Well, the condition of the sleepwalkers amongst us, which are many, and I mean people who are going through life without a clue that there's a deeper meaning
yes.
or anything beyond the physical world, for the sleepwalkers amongst us, it's often necessary to go to sleep in order to wake up because you're trying to fit in with other people's expectations, with consensual definitions of reality all day long. You're letting other people tell you who you are. You're letting other people tell you the story of your life. That's the condition many of us are in for much of the time. And to get out of that, sometimes we have to go to sleep and wake up and in our dreams remember that there's more to life, more to meaning, more to our fundamental purpose in this world than that. Mm-hmm. However, if you are at least halfway awakened, you don't have to go to sleep in order to dream, let alone get the messages, because they're all around you.
Mm-hmm.
You start listening and quivering with excitement as the world gives you a series of rhymes, a symbol comes up again and again, and you begin to notice, hey, wait a minute, something is speaking to me. So this is one of the ways of being a dreamer in waking life and being awakened in waking life.
And it seems to me, Robert, that it's kind of like this spiraling effect where once you start awakening to it, you realize there are more and more signs, or perhaps you receive more and more signs. And it can be absolutely amusing sometimes how we are inundated with them. And once we awaken to it, it's like, holy crap, we've got guidance galore.
Yes, well, there are two important things in what you just said. The first is the spiral motif. One of the games I put out in my book, Sidewalk Oracles, is look for the spiral question mark. That means notice when recurring symbols or situations come up in your life again and again. You meet the same kind of guy. What are you going to do this time? You're going to make the mistake you made last time. You're going to recognize that life is circling around, and therefore you can put yourself on the spiral path of not being bound to the wheel of repetition, but noticing the resemblance between a new situation and a previous one and gain from that and operate in the understanding you can make better choices. So that's part of the spiral path and noticing the spiral pattern. What you're talking about, which is right on the money, it's right on target for this, is the following. We can become magnetic. I mean, we can become strange attractors for synchronicity and coincidence. Our experience of these things, not just our observation of them, grows as we make more room for them. We're more open to them. We're ready to play for them. We attract, I think, a simple idea that many people will grasp. It's been almost sort of turned into a cartoon version in the New Age version of the law of attraction. But something that most of us understand is that there is magnetism at work in our lives. Our thoughts and feelings influence the events and situations we encounter.
Mm-hmm.
Our attitude is always going ahead of us, shaping what we will encounter around the next corner. So if you're open to the idea there might be more magic in ordinary life than many people allow for, then you will draw more magic to you. If you carry magic inside you, you will find magic around you. If you don't carry magic inside you, good luck.
So you've been using this term synchronicity, and lots of people use this. What is your definition, Robert, of synchronicity?
Well, synchronicity is a word made up by Mr. Jung, who was a classical scholar as well as all the other things he was. And he made it up because he realized it's awfully hard to get people to talk sensibly about coincidence. The word is it sounds respectable, it sounds scientific, so I use it. I've made up some other words. We'll get to those in a moment. All it literally means etymologically is things happening at the same time. But that's not the essence of the phenomenon. The essence of the phenomenon of meaningful coincidence, which is synchronicity, is that something inside you meets something outside you, and you know that the inner and the outer are connected, the subjective and the objective are connected. Ooh. It's a moment, I would say, when the universe gets personal, and you know it in your feelings. You know it's important because you get shivers, you get quivers, you recognize that time is operating differently. Jung said this only once, and he said it just in one interview with a great Romanian mythographer and novelist, Mircea Eliade. Jung said once, synchronicity is, in brief, quote, a rupture in time. I love that phrase. Oh. I wish he'd unfolded what it means.
I've done that in
my book. He came up with that phrase, but then he never developed it. I've developed it. It is a sense of a rupture in time. You feel time is working differently. You feel as if time has stopped or expanded, or you feel that something from outside ordinary time is coming through into your world of time. That's a fundamental quality or characteristic of the experience of synchronicity.
Wonderful. We have to go to a quick break, but more with the fascinating Robert Moss when we return here in a few moments.
Access Consciousness is coming back to Seattle this April for three amazing events. Mark your calendars. April 20th through the 22nd is the Access Consciousness Body Classes, created by Gary Douglas and Dr. Dane here. Facilitated by Dr. Glenna Rice. Explore verbal processes and hands-on bodywork that will unlock the tension, resistance, and dis-ease of the body by shifting energy dynamically. April 23rd through the 25th is the Advanced Access Body Class with Gary Douglas. What if you could undo a whole lot of limitations that you have locked into your body and create an alteration of the way your body functions? Then, on April 26th at 7 p.m., join Gary Douglas for the Abuse Hold class. This is the first time ever that this dynamic process is being presented in a class format. Find out more about these Access Consciousness April events in Seattle by visiting transformation.events. That's transformation.events.
Serenity Bliss Holistic Spa is a complete approach to wellness. Serenity Bliss offers integrated therapies for whole body health, from facials to massage, from laser skin treatments to herbal wellness, from chiropractic care to energy healing. We work with teens who want to put their best face forward, adults of all ages who want to maintain that youthful glow, and anyone who wants to enjoy vibrant well-being head to toe. Serenity Bliss Holistic Spa is bringing the European approach to restoring natural beauty and wellness here to the Seattle area. Located on the east side, off the beaten path, yet just minutes from the freeway. If you'd like to experience the joy of relaxation, skincare excellence, and total wellness, then come experience your Serenity Bliss. To learn more or to schedule an appointment, visit SerenityBlissHolisticSpa.com. That's SerenityBlissHolisticSpa.com. Or call 206-229-0086.
On the cutting edge of the new mainstream, Christine Upchurch is passionate about bringing together science, psychology, and spirituality in a way that can be applied to our everyday lives for true transformation. The Christine Upchurch Show. Stellar conversations to illuminate your journey. Engages some of the most outstanding visionaries on the planet in lively dialogue to inspire you to become that bright light you're meant to be. Join Christine every Friday at 11 a.m. Pacific Time on KKNW, AM 1150, and Transformation Talk Radio.
I'm Peggy Snow with another Stellar Reflections Minute. Presence, or what we think of as being fully in the moment, is a key element in the process of healing work. As a practitioner facilitating a session, genuine presence takes us out of our heads, where we tend to decide what is and maybe what should be for the client, and moves us into direct experience where we're available to witness the person in their wholeness. In this receptive realm, our senses are heightened and expanded, allowing us to perceive what's seeking to unfold and to interact in the moment. There's something profoundly powerful that happens when healing is approached in this simple, pure way. Balance can be restored and healing can take place on multiple levels. If you'd like more information about the services we offer at Stellar Reflections, visit us at stellarreflections.com or call 425-999-9836. That's 425-999-9836.
Welcome back to the Christine Upchurch Show here on KKNW and Transformation Talk Radio. I'm having a conversation with Robert Moss today, and he's the author of many books, including Sidewalk Oracles. Now, Robert, before the break, we were talking about synchronicity and this concept of perhaps it's a rupture in time, the universe is getting personal. How do we tap in to this magic of synchronicity?
Well, we have to be open to begin with. I mean, if we're going around wearing blinkers fixed with our agendas and our schedules, we're going to miss what the world is giving us. If we are estranged from nature, we're going to miss a lot of it. Though I must say that synchronicity will pursue us through any medium that is available to us, including Facebook, email, the internet, things that pop up, drop phone calls, typos. I mean, the synchronicity imps will get through to us one way or another. But it starts by being open. It continues through paying attention with it when you notice things are starting to operate a bit differently. For example, you cannot find a book on your shelf, though you're certain it's there. It's been hidden. You feel it's been hidden from you. Alternatively, a book drops off the shelf.
Yes.
What does that mean? The shelf elf perhaps is at play, that playful imp, library imp, bookcase imp, to make sure that certain texts appear or disappear. Then when you start to feel that time is working differently, you're in a special moment, maybe a moment of revelation, you want to be ready to say thank you, thank you. Things are happening differently. I'm not alone in the universe. There are deeper forces in play. And then you want to take action to honor all of this. So that's how you get good at it. And by learning these things, you become what I call a chiromancer. Now, you asked me about the word synchronicity. Jung invented that, but I've invented a new term of my own, which is no less interesting. The term is chiromancy. It's the term for divination by synchronicity, which means getting really good, noticing how the synchronicity phenomenon plays out, being poised to take advantage of it. And in the word, I've used the name of one of the two Greek gods of time. There's old Kronos, the god of linear time.
Right.
And then there's Kairos, K-A-I-R-O-S, who's a frisky, tricky, slippery, beautiful young god of opportunity time, the time of the special moment when things are working differently, when you've got an opportunity and you need to grab it right away. That's what Kairos is about. So when I say chiromancy, that means divination by special moments, being ready to catch the special moment. Notice when time is working differently and act in that moment. Get good at it and you become a chiromancer. And doesn't that sound like a romantic and mysterious thing to be?
It does, and I love this concept of it being divine guidance that we are meant to act upon.
What simple folk used to say is that coincidence is God's way of remaining anonymous. Well, I rather love that. Whether we want to use the word God or goddess or the spirits or nature or whatever, there's something in that old simple concept that, you know, when things are happening differently, when things pop up, you know it's meaningful, and you know that, you know, the pink flamingo in your drive right now is not accidental. It wasn't dropped off by a neighbor for a prank, or if it was, that is a special moment. When you notice a moment of revelation in these symbol things popping up in everyday life, then you sometimes feel the hidden hand. You know, I learn about these things and teach them by story. Shall I give you a story?
Oh,
about
absolutely.
That special
I would love for you to share an experience of how you apply chiromancy.
Well, let's give an example of that. Let's stay with your theme of the sense of the divine, the God, goddess, the spirit popping up. And also, this takes us into the whole idea that when you're alive to this stuff, you find yourself walking on a mythic edge in life. You find yourself closer to those deeper stories, those dramas preserved in mythology and in talk of the archetypes. You feel them at play close to you. So, all right, so I'm flying to Denver en route to the Boulder bookstore, one of my favorite independents, to read from my poetry collection a few years ago.
Uh-huh.
And I'm on the first flight, and there's a feisty older lady there, even older than me, who talks just like me. I've got this funny Anglo-Australian accent with all the things woven in. I meet very few people who talk exactly like me. And I say to her, "You talk just like me." And she says, "Of course," she says, "I'm Helen of Troy." And I look at this lady. We're on a mythic kick here. In my bag, I have copies of Homer and other Greek epics in translation because I've dreamed that I'm writing something like a Greek epic. Uh-huh. So we're off and running. She's talking about Troy, New York. She's making a joke. I used to live in Troy, New York, so the synchronicity deepens.
Right.
We're off on a mythic kick. Now I'm at the Boulder bookstore. I met by a girl at the reception desk who says, my name is Athena. So I say, quick as a whip, I say, where's Odysseus? She says, wait, Odysseus works for the store. We'll page him. Paging Odysseus, and appears this muscular, good-looking young guy with streaming hair and beard, looks like an Achaean from Homer's Trojan War. Uh-huh. Odysseus, is that really your name? Yes, my parents were in Greece when I was conceived. They decided to call me Odysseus. Okay, next day I'm recording a TV program for the Gaia Network out there near Boulder, and the girl who pours my coffee is called Gaia, like the Greek earth goddess, with a big serpent tattoo down her arm. And I'm talking about this in the studio when they ask me, how do you live by synchronicity? I'm saying, sometimes you feel those powers behind the curtain sort of snickering. So you give him another one. Is he noticing anything yet? And I start mentioning Helen of Troy, Athena, Odysseus. Say, wait, let's get Icarus. He works for the show. Let's get Icarus in from the production studio. So Icarus comes in to join the conversation about how life rhymes, sometimes in the name of Greek gods and heroes out of Homer. So that's one of those days when they're laying it on so thickly. By they, I mean those powers of the world behind the world, concealed behind the curtain of our everyday thinking. Sometimes they lay it on so fast and thick, you cannot fail to miss it.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Well, you know, I have my own experiences, and as many of my listeners know, I helped bring in this energetic process called the 111 activation, and it came through beginning early in the wee hours of 111-11. So we decided to name it the 111, and I'm not exactly sure if we're supposed to do anything with this or if I'm going to change my life to sort of bring it forward. About 2 weeks later, I came home from work. I was tired. Normally, I just like cook dinner right away, feed the hungry kids, you know, but I just felt like I had to sit down. And I'm not one to just turn on the TV generally, but I felt like turning on the TV. And so I'm looking through the channel guide, and there's nothing on, right? I'm thinking, why are there 900 channels when there's nothing to watch? And then I heard this whisper in my ear, check out what's on channel 111. So I scrolled up to 111 on the guide, and it was The New Adventures of the Old Christine.
That's very sweet, isn't it?
Yeah, so it's like...
Isn't that delicious?
It is. And so it's not just the numbers. You think, well, okay, maybe that's a coincidence. But this was just like... You know, I mean, it's so obvious.
Yes, you're asking what's required, you know, to get good at this, at monitoring synchronicity and so on. I think part of it is a regression, if you like, to a sort of rather animistic way of thinking about things. The old idea that everything's alive in the world, everything's alive and has some degree of consciousness and might be interacting. I mean, let me give you a quick example. I came back from a trip. I fly all the time a few weeks ago, and I'd had to deal in that workshop with a very difficult lady who had had the great disappointment and fear and frustration of losing her wallet. Anyway, she's having all sorts of problems. I had to sort of calm her, bring her through. She found her wallet in the end. Now I'm home, and I got home 2 o'clock in the morning. I'm getting up at 6 o'clock, bleary-eyed Christine, and I can't find my wallet. I cannot find my wallet. I call everybody, cancel credit cards, blah, blah, blah. I have an international trip coming up, and I've got my passport and so on. So I set off, missing most of the things from my wallet, including a lot of cash, etc. Anyway, after 2 weeks of constant travel to Europe and other places, I come back and I find my wallet, the one I lost, in an inexplicable place. It's on top of a row of fiction in a bookcase in my house, where I've never put anything like that before. And I'd noticed that the shelf elves of the house imps are saying to me, Robert, look, write fiction again. Notice where you put your wallet. It's next to these fiction writers that you like. You used to write best-selling novels. Don't fail to notice that money, lots of money, credit, identity, and other things are in the fiction part of the bookcase. They got a message to me, in my opinion, in this roundabout, tricksterish way. And I'm just animist enough about the universe, just animist enough to think that everything's speaking and communicating in some way to receive that message.
Right. And it's interesting to me because you had just been with somebody who vibrationally, you know, had the vibration of having lost their wallet.
Yeah.
And so it's kind of like, well, you know, it's almost like the guides, whoever, whatever they might be, were taking advantage of that vibration that was now in your field to sort of give you that message that way.
That's extremely perceptive, because the other funny thing was I'd been coached and rehearsed by my work with the woman who was really having a fit over losing her wallet. I was completely calm, relaxed, even humorous about having lost my wallet. I was not fazed in the slightest. Uh-huh. I went through this with a preternatural calm, which would not be the way I would normally expect to react, but I'd been rehearsed and coached for it.
Yeah. Fascinating. So, I love this quote. It says, you've got this game called Listen for Your Daily Cleidon. Is that how you pronounce it?
Well, I'd say Cleidon. Frankly, nobody's quite too sure how to pronounce ancient Greek, but Cleidon would be my best guess for that word. Yeah, want to hear about that?
Yes, please.
Do we have time for another quick story before the break?
We've got about 2 minutes before the next
break. Oh, 2 minutes. Yeah. All right, okay. Well, the Cleidon was one of the Greeks' favorite ways of playing the world as an oracle. It had many ways of approaching oracles, Delphi, famous one, all of that. The Cleidon, what the Cleidon is, it's sounds or speech coming out of silence or maybe out of the unvariegated hubbub of a public place, marketplace, noise, busy streets. So you hear a snap, you hear a phrase, you hear a dog, you hear a bird, you hear a bit of a soundtrack, you hear something from someone's headphones. That might be your Cleidon of the day. So here's an example of how I got a message in this way while walking my funny little dog, my 20-pound miniature schnauzer, to the park. I've got something on my mind. I'm in the state of divided thinking and divided loyalties. I've taken on two huge projects. They're going to start in the fall. Uh-huh. I'm starting to think I can't handle both of them at once. What do I do? So that's on my mind. Big guy gets, who I don't know, gets a big truck, big box on his shoulder. He looks at me. He looks at the miniature dog and he says, "Well, he can kill both of us at once, can he?" And I'm sort of stunned by this jokester. I stagger up the road thinking, what's that? I suddenly get it. He's just told me I've got to cancel one of the projects. I can't handle them both at once.
Right.
So I've got a message. But the beauty of it is this. It's now a difficult diplomatic scene to pass on the disappointing news to one of the project managers, let's call him, that I'm not going to do it. Uh-huh. But I pluck up my courage. I call him an hour later, and I'm telling him that I can't do the project. He's disappointed. He's actually upset. Then I tell him the moment of decision. He can't kill both of us at once, can he? And the guy on the end of the phone starts laughing. Oh, Robert, I get it. The synchronicity stuff. I get it. You made the only decision you could. Uh-huh. So getting the Cleidon, the odd words from the stranger in the street, not only gave me a decision, it gave me the way to communicate the decision, made all come out sweet.
Right. Like it's all divine guidance. We have to go to another quick break, but more with Robert Moss will return here in a few moments.
Discover the 8 things the elements of prosperity want you to know. Lynn Brown is hosting a life-transforming, soul-expanding evening on April 30th featuring guest speaker and radio host Dr. Pat Basile. Lynn was guided to make this a by-donation event for entrance, and all proceeds will be donated towards uplifting the homeless community. For more information and to get tickets, visit eventbrite.com. That's eventbrite.com and type Lynn Brown in the search.
Hey everybody, this is Dr. Pat. Many of you have heard me talk about the Lyme disease epidemic going on right now in the world. I want to tell you about my friends at Results RNA. They have now created an entire Lyme support system for immune system support, detoxification, rejuvenation, and neurological healing. Please visit ResultsRNA.com to learn more. And for first-time orders, you'll receive a special 10% discount. All you have to do is type in Dr. Pat at checkout.
Called the Oprah of radio by her listeners, award-winning host Dr. Pat Basile is blowing the doors off of traditional talk radio. Get ready for an energizing delivery and powerful interviews with leaders in the field of human potential. Dr. Pat's fresh, new perspective on living life full out has catapulted her show to the top of talk radio. Tune in and Dr. Pat will help you thrive instead of merely survive. Visit thedrpatshow.com. That's thedrpatshow.com for listening times in your area.
I'm Christine Upchurch, and this is a Stellar Reflections Minute. Years ago, when facing cancer, without any immediate treatment options, I sought healing by making various life changes. For a while, I followed a very restrictive diet. I often found myself obsessing about which foods were good and which ones were bad. Then one day, I realized I was consuming foods based on fear. Fear of not getting well. But I didn't want to make choices out of fear anymore. I decided it was far better for my immune system if I allowed myself to experience the joy that came from, say, eating frozen yogurt, than it was for me to ingest the fear that came from avoiding it. Now, instead of choosing healthy habits based on fear, I try to make choices because they feel right and ultimately bring me joy and ease. How many of your healthy habits are really based on fear? Please visit stellarreflections.com or call 425-999-9836. That's 425-999-9836.
On the cutting edge of the new mainstream, Christine Upchurch is passionate about bringing together science, psychology, and spirituality in a way that can be applied to our everyday lives for true transformation. The Christine Upchurch Show, stellar conversations to illuminate your journey, engages some of the most outstanding visionaries on the planet in lively dialogue to inspire you to become that bright light you're meant to be. Join Christine every Friday at 11 a.m. Pacific Time on KKNW, AM 1150, and Transformation Talk Radio.
Welcome back to the Christine Upchurch Show here on KKNW, CRN, and Transformation Talk Radio. It's funny because Benny has to interrupt wonderful conversation to say, hey, you guys are coming back on air.
Sometimes I feel so bad. Yes.
And we do enjoy our conversations here, don't we, Benny, with our wonderful guests when we're off the air as well as on the air. And thank you for doing what you do to make sure that everybody can hear these conversations.
I'm kind of an urban wrangler, I guess, of emotions and spirit.
You know, I just love your work, Robert. I'm talking to Robert Moss, you know, author, dream teacher, teacher of navigating synchronicity. And Robert, I know that you come to the Seattle area quite often, and we've got a lot of listeners here in the Seattle area. What do you have that's coming up soon here in Seattle?
Well, actually, coming up quite soon, we have two marvelous adventures, 45 minutes from Seattle out at Mosswood Hollow. I don't own the place. It's great synchronicity that the owners called it Mosswood Hollow before they'd heard of me and then led to go out there. I've been teaching there for a long time. It's my favorite place to teach in the universe. Think across between Hogwarts and Wind in the Willows. Uh-huh. Anyway. At Mosswood Hollow in May, wait for this. I mean, this is so much fun. I'm doing the best writing retreat in the universe. Yes, I'll be hyper about this because it's justified. I'm doing my 5-day retreat, Writing as a State of Conscious Dreaming. I'm doing that at Mosswood Hollow, coming up in May, May 16th to 20th.
Before we get to the next one, how is that writer's retreat different from others?
Oh, well, for example, let me count the ways. We had a novelist one time, published novelist, who was blocked with a new novel. We play-acted the next 3 chapters for her. We acted it out. I played the chief villain. We acted out the 3 unwritten chapters. She took notes. She got the book finished. She got it published the next year. I mean, come on.
Wonderful. Yeah.
We're using our dreaming technique. I take people on a journey to a magic library where they meet a master teacher. They read pages of the book or the script they haven't written yet. They bring them back.
Ooh.
I mean, we're absolutely in tune with everybody there. We do our coincidence card game in which people write down a bit of a story. We shuffle the cards. You pull a card. You get a lead for your writing. You can borrow or steal the story that's just been handed to you and make something of it. So, you know, and we're dreamers. So we're shifting consciousness. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we'll do a 5-minute quickie writing exercise. You produce a page overnight. You'll always be supported and cheered on. And we will absolutely adapt to who you are and what you're doing. No judgment.
And these are very personalized
It's a tiny personalized. We will gather around each individual with their own project and support it in its own terms. Mm-hmm. So we might play act the missing chapters of the novel, but we might do something completely different. You're writing a memoir about your dad. I mean, it sounds like play acting again, but somebody might play your dad and you can talk to them and get feedback from your dad as you read to them the memoir you're writing, for example. And because we're doing journeying with shamanic drumming and so on, we can send people to places that other approaches do not reach. We reach the paths that other approaches do not reach.
That sounds like a wild ride and very effective.
It is. It's incredible. I have incredible time myself. I love the writing I myself do. Anyway, just to stay on this line for a moment, we're doing a weekend workshop on Saturday, Sunday, May 21, May 22, called Become a Chiromancer. I was talking about what a chiromancer is earlier. A chiromancer is someone who is really sharp and good about noticing synchronicity, seizing that special moment and doing something with it. Uh-huh. So we're doing a weekend of coincidence games. Uh-huh. We'll do some dream work, of course. You have the book in front of you, Sidewalk Oracles, which has 17 or 18 of the games that I've developed or invented. We'll be playing many of those in that workshop, and that's coming up at Mosswood Hollow, not far from Seattle, on May 21st, 22nd. And for details of these things, you want to go to mossdreams.com, my website. And hey, I'm starting to sound like a busker now, so you better put me back on whatever road you want me to be on.
So, Robert, I'm excited about your events here in Seattle, and I know that you go all over the world as well. But getting back to this topic at hand about navigating synchronicity and taking that divine guidance, I know you've got many of these games, as you're just talking about, in this wonderful book. Can you share with the listeners another one of the games that might be fun to implement?
Well, I like playing what I've taken to calling sidewalk tarot. I mean, the idea is if you pay attention, the world is dealing you tarot cards, one in one, threes, fives, whatever, all the time. And a tarot deck, as you know, has 78 cards, but the world deck has any number of cards. So the trick is to notice what is in play. And to play sidewalk tarot, there are two basic modes of doing it. The first is you've got a theme on your mind. Shall I sell the house? Shall I call the divorce lawyer? Whatever it is. Uh-huh. You've got a theme on your mind, and you go out into the world, and you accept the first one, two, or three things. Make it your own choice. The first one, two, or three striking, unusual things that enter your field of perception as a response from the world, and you play with them in your mind as if they are tarot cards. You find the symbolism. You find the story. Sometimes you get the answer right away. I was talking to someone yesterday who had a question about relationship. Actually, she wanted to know, you know, whether something she suspected about a partner was true or not. She went out to do sidewalk tarot. Immediately a sign flashes on something in front of her. It says, "You betcha." It wasn't what she wanted to see, but it was the answer right in her face. Okay, you betcha. Okay, that's the way it is. Now, how do I work with that? The other way to do sidewalk tarot, it might be highway tarot. You might be doing this in your car.
Sure.
So there are all sorts of variations, or tarot in the woods. But the next way to do it is not to set your intention for guidance, not to say, I would like guidance on such and such, but give yourself, you know, a small expanse of unscheduled time when you're free to wander. It might be your commute, might be your lunch break, depends what your life is like. Uh-huh. Give yourself 20 minutes of unscheduled time and notice what the world is saying to you. Collect impressions in that period of time. Three impressions would be good, but you could make it any number and make a story out of them. What is the world saying to me today? And listen with all of your senses, not just your eyes and your ears, but your sense of smell, for example. What is in the air literally today, and what messages do you get from that? That's a great way to put yourself in league with the animate world around you. And if you're out in a natural place, or even if you're in the city listening to crows and dogs and other things, you'll find that the speaking land, as Aborigines call it, has messages for you any day, any time.
So why is it important for us to take these signs, these symbols, these messages, and incorporate it into a story?
Well, because we live by stories, actually. If you don't know that you're living by a story, then you're probably living in the wrong kind of story. You're probably wound up, wrapped up, buttoned down in a story that is too small for you. We live by stories. It's fundamental to the human condition. So getting a story out of these circumstances of everyday life is already magic. It's already magic. You're already beginning to get shaped to your experiences. You're already beginning to get creative. You're already beginning, as you learn to tell these things to other people, to develop the power of the storyteller, to communicate and to be to build an audience in it for any situation which wants to listen to you. So there are so many reasons in this. I mean, there's I myself look at it this way. I'll put up with almost anything in life if it has entertainment value in the sense it could be turned into a story worth telling. But I am both by vocation a storyteller. But you know what? We all need. We need our stories. We do need our stories. We need to find them. This is one of the Aborigines again say, the big stories are hunting the right people to tell them, like predators in the bush, like sharks in the water. The big stories are looking for you. And you could change the language. You could say the greater powers are hunting you. Right. Or your greater self, your greater life purpose is hunting you. The trick is to put yourself in a place where you could be found. Because when your larger story has jumped on you, Christine, everything changes. Nothing is the same. Yeah. It's different. You have a sense of drama in the good sense, even the mythic sense, that can carry you through the most difficult and tawdry days.
Right. And it, I think there's this underlying assumption that some people actually don't buy into, and that is that we are fully supported on this journey and have guidance to lead us to a more fulfilling life every step of the way.
Well, I think we do, but I think absolutely. But I also think we're required to brave up in order to enlist the support of greater powers.
Uh-huh.
I mean, I hear people in this new age talking about, for example, who are into the animal spirits, the power, talking about my lion, my tiger, my wolf, etc. Nonsense. I mean, it's not your tiger, your lion, your wolf. And if you first met it, when you first met it, you didn't have a shiver of fear, or you'd probably not for real. I mean, greater resources come to us, greater allies come to us, we take on greater challenges. Yes, we are supported, but we're also being encouraged and goaded to do something creative, which always involves taking a risk. The interesting things happen on the edge in life, and always implies risk.
I love that. We have to go to another quick break. More with Robert Moss in just a few moments.
Are you ready to tap into the healer within? Hi, I'm Mary Jane Mack. Did you know the real doctor is the source that lives within you, that heals within you minute by minute every day? The healer within is the innate intelligence of the human body. When we cut our hand with a piece of glass, we don't have to command the body to close the wound and grow new skin. It knows how to heal itself. We do have to nourish the skin by disinfecting it and remove the glass, or it cannot heal. The innate healer relies upon us to assist in this healing process. Our role is to identify its needs, provide the substances required for the healing, and remove the obstacle. Contact us to achieve optimal health at 888-777-4232. That's 888-777-4232. And visit us at MaryJaneMack.com.
This is Peggy Snow, practitioner at Stellar Reflections, with a Stellar Reflections Minute. So many people these days are trying to find ways to relieve their stress. What happens to our breathing when we're feeling overwhelm and stress? When we tune in, we realize that we're either holding our breath or taking very shallow breath to signal the body that all is well, which most of the time it is. Sometimes all that is needed is a nice, deep breath to break the cycle. First, exhale to get all the stale air out by engaging the abdominal muscles and blowing gently. Next, take a nice, full breath in, feeling it fill your body all the way down to your hips. Release fully and enjoy the freedom of movement. Notice how your body feels. Do you feel refreshed? Calmness is only a breath away. This has been a Stellar Reflections Minute. For more information about what we offer at Stellar Reflections, visit us at stellarreflections.com or call 425-999-9836. That's 425-999-9836.
Hi, everyone. This is Dr. Pat. The ancient Inca root vegetable, maca, is world-renowned for its wide array of health benefits. As a family-run company of true maca specialists, the Maca Team's mission is to provide you with fresh, organic, premium-quality maca powders at a fair price. Amazing. All of the products are always organically grown, fair-traded, GMO-free, fresh, and potent. So don't take my word for it. Experience the life-changing benefits of maca today. Visit themacateam.com.
Have you been seeing numbers like 111 and 222 everywhere you go? Do you feel that the universe may be trying to get your attention, perhaps offering a message of some sort? As it turns out, numerical patterns and certain types of geometry form the very fabric of our reality, from cells under a microscope to the astronomy of our night sky. At Stellar Reflections, we offer special sessions which tap into these patterns, designed specifically to support you on your journey. The 111 and 222 activations are sessions activating new patterns in your energy field, which in turn can help you create new patterns in your life. After just one session with a practitioner, either in person or via distance, clients report gaining greater clarity, becoming more intuitive, and honoring their inner truth as they move forward in their lives. Curious about what these transformational sessions might do for you? Call 425-999-9836 or visit stellarreflections.com. That's stellarreflections.com. Welcome back to the Christine Upchurch Show here on KKNW, CRN, and Transformation Talk Radio. Boy, this hour is flying by, Robert. I'm so enjoying our conversation. I know on the break, we were having a conversation about parallel realities. What's your perspective on parallel realities?
Yes. We live right now, you and I and everybody listening, in a parallel world, which I guess we're all sharing in this moment of being together on your wonderful show. But there are parallel universes, uncountable parallel universes, where we've made different choices, some where we're doing things that are near or far to our present, you know, the course of life.
Right.
I mean, physics tells us this is more likely than not. In physics, the theory is now called the theory of many interacting worlds. It used to be called the many worlds theory. Now they're calling it the theory of many interacting or many interactive worlds,
okay,
which is saying not only are we living right now in one of maybe uncountable parallel universes, but they impact each other. For example, we could come closer to the self who made a somewhat different choice and start picking up karma and attributes and situations from each other. One of the ways of knowing about this in everyday life is the experience of deja vu. Mm-hmm. I've met very few people who do not admit to the experience deja vu.
Right.
You come upon a place, you know it from somewhere. How do you know it? Well, I think often you know it because you dreamed it, even if you forgot the dream. But another reason you may know it is that in a parallel life, you may have got to that point before you got to it on your present parallel event track. That's one way of beginning to wake up experientially to how this operates. Another way of waking up to this thing experientially in human terms is to journal your dreams over the long haul and notice those dreams in which in installment after installment after installment, you're living somewhat differently or maybe radically differently, but the story is evolving. The you who never left the UK, in my case, or never left Australia before that, who's still doing something over there.
Right.
The me, to keep it on myself for a minute longer, who's still a best-selling thriller writer, traveling and doing the research for books with the stretch limousines and so on, even if he doesn't want them, that he used to have. You know, I dream of him. I dream of him hundreds of times a year. He's very close to me.
Interesting, yeah. Yeah, and you and I were chatting about how I tuned into parallel reality of the me, who I am, you know, but who never left Lincoln, Nebraska. And it was a very illuminating experience because she was very different. She was very different, same person and yet different. And it's kind of perplexing, particularly because it's not only considering these parallel realities, but time really doesn't make a lot of sense when we're starting to talk about parallel realities. What's your perception on time?
Well, the time is always now. That's my perception of time. The correct time is always now. We have linear time. It's a convenience. We'd probably have trouble with everything happening all at once if we didn't have linear time to sort of order things. But in a fundamental sense, the moment of now is the only moment. And from this moment of now, when we wake up to what it is, we actually can access past, present, and parallel, past, future, and parallel times. I teach people to do this experientially. We go on journeys to explore these things and see if we can revision and change things for the better. Uh-huh. I know we can change the future for the better because we can travel into the future and we can make better choices. I know that. I think that we can do better for ourselves and our parallel selves by checking in on them and drawing lessons from each other and sometimes exchanging gifts. I think we can do that. I think I've done it for myself. I know we can travel to the past and we can do some good for our earlier self. So, for example, if I've left Nebraska or London or somewhere else where I've been, maybe I left a part of myself behind when I made that choice.
Uh-huh.
We're now talking about something beyond parallel lives. We're talking about something that shamans call soul loss. Maybe I left a part of myself who didn't want to come with me when I made that transition.
Right.
Maybe I need to pick her up in some sense and bring her energy back into my life.
Uh-huh.
But also, by tracking what happened in her story on her parallel event track, I'll make some really interesting discoveries. And at the end of it, we may find it's hard to choose which is better or worse. Or
right.
we might find that actually we're doing pretty well in this life compared to what it would be like in that parallel life, so we can actually dispel some regrets. I remember discovering what life would have been like if I'd stayed with former partners of my life. And I said, thank goodness that did break up. I was heartbroken. I was bleeding at the
uh-huh.
time. But thank goodness it broke up, because look at where we'd be now. It's not so great.
Yeah.
So sometimes getting onto this is a way of moving forward with fewer regrets, and that can be really liberating in a life.
Uh-huh. So do you believe that on a moment-to-moment basis we're sort of jumping between realities?
Yeah, I think we are to some extent. I think that sometimes we find ourselves right in the situation of that parallel self who did slightly different things, and maybe our memories are adjusted so we don't actually understand. I mean,
mm-hmm.
if the world's changing all the time, if our lives are changing all the time in this way, maybe our memories are changed so that we don't, apart from some dreams, or
uh-huh.
some senses of deja vu, remember what it was like before. There's a great novel by Ursula Le Guin, an earlier one called The Lathe of Heaven.
Oh, I love that book.
It's yeah. a great little book about dreaming. It's a man whose dreams come true, you know, for the whole community.
Right.
So, for example, he thinks there are too many people living in Portland. So when he wakes up, there are only 10% of the people in Portland left.
Uh-huh.
Nobody notices the change except him. Everybody's wandering around looking dazed, unable to find their office building or whatever. He's the only one who remembers that the day before, Portland had 10 times as many people. It can be a little bit like that, a bit blurry around the edges.
Uh-huh. Yeah, that's a fascinating concept, and I was listening to a short bit of channeling from Bashar, and he was saying when somebody was really worried about the future of our world, and he was saying it's a choice, and he was talking about it's not just a choice about, like, what action we do and what choices we make, and eventually, but it's really a choice of which parallel reality we're going to hop onto.
Yes. Yes, I think that's actually true. And there was another. I'm going very fictional today, I guess. There are reasons without that shelf elf who hid my wallet for a while and left in the fiction section. But there's a great novel by Philip K. Dick, poorly turned into a TV series recently, The Man in the High Castle. And it's about an alternate reality. It seems as if the Axis powers, Germany and Japan, won World War II and the U.S. is under Japanese and German occupation. But there are people who have the sort of sense that reality isn't quite like that. And somehow when they're able to see the alternate version, the world shifts to the one more like the one that we know, in which, you know, the Allies won the World War and so on. There is a great deal of truth, and we get this from quantum physics and the idea that the act of observation changes things. In
right.
the quantum reality that physics tells us about, things come into manifestation through the act of observation, through
yes.
the act of seeing. I think this works on human levels in a way that it's hard for us to get our brains around, but we're actually, in a sense, already inside it. How we see things changes them. What we see and what we fail uh-huh. to see changes things.
Right.
So it's all about observing how we observe, what the act of observation leads to. This isn't really as abstruse as it might sound. It's actually on the very edge of what you were talking about, our ability to choose which reality we inhabit
uh-huh.
and maybe to shift from one parallel event track to another for ourselves and even for our world.
Right, right. And yes, and the sense that perhaps they all exist to begin with, and it's just a matter of what we're going to focus on in this moment.
Yes. I was reading the other day a story from the East. It's an Urdu story from Urdu literature, a language of Pakistan, about the tradition of a sheikh, a mystical sheikh,
uh-huh.
Who's consulted by somebody, by a merchant who thinks he faces a bad future and could be murdered. And according to the story, the sheikh shifted the event to a dream world in which it didn't happen in the physical world. He shifted a whole course of events from physical manifestation into an alternate reality described as a dream state. I think that kind of thing is a glimmering from world literature of what is actually possible and maybe what is going on all the time. To bring more consciousness to all of this, more technique. I teach technique. I teach practice. It is a very fascinating enterprise.
Right. And, you know, there's some wonderful techniques in your book, Sidewalk Oracles, Playing with Signs, Symbols, and Synchronicity in Everyday Life. And I know you're coming to Seattle. And again, let's see, it's May 16th to 20th for the Writer's Retreat. And then Chiromancing is Saturday and Sunday, May 21st and 22nd. And I'm so grateful you joined me here again today, Robert. I always thoroughly enjoy our conversation.
Oh, you're a delight. And let me just say quickly, I do online courses now for the Shift Network. Those are worth checking out. They're in the world of fun. All of this is going to bring a champagne fizz of excitement to your everyday life.
Wonderful. And it's mossdreams.com. Thanks, Robert. And thank you all for joining us here today. I look forward to talking to you again sometime soon. Bye, everybody.
You've been listening to The Christine Upchurch Show, stellar conversations to illuminate your journey. Each week, this show engages some of the most outstanding visionaries on the planet in lively dialogue to inspire you to become that bright light you're meant to be. Join Christine every Friday at 11 a.m. Pacific Time on KKNW, AM 1150, and TransformationTalkRadio.com. For more information about the transformative healing work of Christine, visit www.stellarreflections.com. And for weekly topics, visit www.transformationtalkradio.com.